Hello and a very warm welcome to the Question Hour show from the Parliament House complex, where we get you all the important unstarred questions that were asked by the members of the Rajya Sabha during the previous session and the response given by the government in the written format. I'm Kriti Mishra, and joining me is my colleague Vishal.
Well, thank you so much, Kriti. So let's take our viewers through these questions. And the first question in today's show is addressed to the Ministry of Communications. And this one comes from member A.K. Selvaraj, who wants to know from the government whether it is a fact that the government has imposed penalty on telecom companies for call drop.
The government in its reply says that the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, or TRAI, has been monitoring the performance of telecom service providers against the benchmark of various quality of service parameters, including call drops laid down by TRAI by way of quality of service regulations issued from time to time through quarterly performance monitoring reports. The performance is assessed for the licensed service area, or LSA, as a whole. TRAI Act 1997 does not provide for imposition of any penalty on telecom service providers directly by TRAI. Only the courts can impose penalty under the Act based on a complaint filed by TRAI for violation of its directions, regulations and orders. The government further says that in the quality of service regulations issued by TRAI, provisions have been made for imposition of financial disinvestments for non-compliance with the benchmarks for various quality of service parameters, including call drop. TRAI has issued the standards for quality of service for basic wireline and cellular mobile telephone services, Fifth Amendment Regulation 2017, effective from 1st of October 2017. These regulations have prescribed two revised parameters for assessing call drop in mobile network, and that includes drop call rate spatial distribution measure, which implies that at least 90% of cells in the network should perform better than specified 2% benchmark on at least 90% of days. Similarly, another new parameter, DCR temporal distribution measure, will give confidence that at least 90% of days network performed better than specified 3% benchmark for at least 97% of the cells. With effect from 1st of October 2017, TRAI has also introduced a revised graded financial disinvestments structure for DCR parameters based on the extent to which the TSP's performance deviates from the specified DSR mark. The next question is by member Saroj Pandey to the Ministry of Communications, and she has asked whether the validity of license for 2G services for the public sector telecom company BSNL is getting expired.
Well, the Ministry of Communications, in response to this question, says that BSNL is presently providing mobile services through cellular mobile telephone service, that is CMTS license. Now, CMTS license is a technology agnostic, and any mobile service, including 2G, 3G or 4G services, can be provided. Present CMTS license of BSNL is expiring on 28th of February 2020. As per the present policy enumerated in Unified License Guidelines issued on 19th of August 2013, extension of CMTS Unified Access Service License, that is USSL, has been discontinued. Policy clearly states that on expiry of one of their current licenses, the telecom service provider shall have to migrate its licenses to Unified License with relevant authorizations at the time of renewal, extension of license and obtain spectrum separately, which is delinked from Unified License. Now, BSNL can obtain UL license with AS authorization to continue providing mobile services beyond 28th of February 2020. The BSNL has already started 4G services in its licensed service areas by using existing spectrum of 2,100 MHz band and 5,921 numbers of 4G BTS have been commissioned so far. BSNL has requested the Department of Telecom to grant additional spectrum with government support for providing 4G services, and these requests have already been included in the revival plan of BSNL. 5G services are still to be launched by the telecom service providers, including BSNL, in India. Well, the next question is to the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, and this one is from member CM Ramesh, who wants to know from the government about the implications of the decision of USA to formally terminate India's eligibility for a duty-free import scheme for developing countries, and the details.
In the response, the government says that India exported goods valued $6.3 billion to the US under the GSP program during the calendar year 2018, which was 12.1% of India's total exports to the US in that year. The total duty concessions occurring on account of GSP were approximately $240 million in 2018, which was about 3.8% of India's exports to the US availing GSP benefits in the year 2018. These concessions will no longer be available. The government further says that issues related to dairy products and medical device were part of GSP review instituted by the US, which led to the above outcome. The next question is by member Kirodi Lal Meena, and Mr. Meena has asked whether the government will review the programs to help startups grow in India.
Well, the government's response to this question is in negative, and it further says that direct funding support to startups is not envisaged under Startup India program. Rather, Government of India has established fund of funds for startups to meet the funding needs of these startups. Now, Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, Government of India is the monitoring agency, and Small Industries Development Bank of India, SIDBI, is the operating agency for FFS. As per the operating guidelines issued by DPIIT, FFS contributes to the corpus of SEBI-registered alternative investment funds. Now, these AIFs, in turn, have to invest at least twice the contribution under FFS in startups as defined by the Government of India. Each AIF set up its own investment committee, and the investment committee of each fund takes a decision on its investment. Now, the AIFs supported under FFS have supported 249 startups as on June 13th, 2019. Now, the investment committee of each AIF, comprising of investment experts drawn from different domains, take decisions on investing into particular startup. These decisions are largely a matter of business decisions, which depend on a host of factors like uniqueness, innovativeness, intellectual property, business potential, etc. Also, the government says that a formal mechanism has been put in place in form of a monitoring committee to review progress of Startup India program on regular basis. The monitoring committee comprises representatives from DPIIT, Niti Aayog, Department of Revenue, from Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises, Department of Science and Technology, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Department of Higher Education, and Small Industries Development Bank of India, that is SIDBI. Lastly, the monitoring committee continuously reviews progress and implementation of various measures for the growth of startup ecosystem. The next question is by the member G.C. Chandrasekhar, and this one is addressed to the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, wherein the member wants to know whether adequate steps have been taken by the government to ensure the availability of timely supply of urea and other fertilizers to the farmers.
The government has listed out the steps taken to ensure the availability of adequate supply of urea and other fertilizers to the farmers across the country. And now these include, before the commencement of each cropping season, Department of Agriculture, Cooperation and Farmers Welfare, in consultation with all the state governments, assesses the requirements of fertilizers. After the assessment of the requirement, the department projects month-wise requirement of fertilizers, and on the basis of month-wise and state-wise projection given by the department, Department of Fertilizers allocates sufficient or adequate quantities of fertilizers to states by issuing monthly supply plan and continuously monitors the availability through the following system. Now, the system includes the movement of all major subsidized fertilizers is being monitored throughout the country by an online web-based monitoring system called Integrated Fertilizer Monitoring System, or IFMS. The state governments are regularly advised to coordinate with manufacturers and importers of fertilizers for streamlining the supplies through timely placement of incidents of railway rakes through their state institutional agencies like Market Fed. Regular weekly video conference is conducted jointly by Department of Agriculture and Cooperation and Farmers Welfare, Department of Fertilizers and Ministry of Railways with state agriculture officials, and corrective actions are taken to dispatch fertilizer as indicated by the state government. The gap between demand, which is also called requirement, and production is met through imports. The import for the season is also finalized well in advance to ensure timely availability of fertilizer. Thus, with all these steps as indicated, Department of Fertilizers ensures availability of fertilizer at the state level, and the distribution to the farmers within the state is the responsibility of the respective state government. The next question is by member Hussein Dalwai, and this one is also to the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. And Mr. Dalwai has asked about the details of the impact of Pradhan Mantri Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana along with the details of modifications in the scheme since its inception.
Well, the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers has given a very detailed answer in response to Mr. Dalvai's question, and it says that as on 19th of July 2019, under Pradhan Mantri Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana, that is PMBJP, 5,451 Jan Aushadhi Kendras are functional across the country. Out of total 723 districts of the country, 680 are already covered under PMBJP. The product basket of PMBJP comprises 900 drugs and 154 surgicals and consumables. Further, total sales in the financial year 2018-19 crossed 315 crore rupees, which led to a total savings of approximately 2,000 crore rupees of common citizens, as these medicines are cheaper by 50 to 90% as compared to the corresponding branded medicines. Further, the ministry says that as on 19th of July 2019, 358 Jan Aushadhi Kendras are opened in the states of Maharashtra. 34 districts out of the 36 districts of the state are already covered. Efforts are on to cover the remaining two districts, that is Ratnagiri and Gadchiroli. In addition to the Bureau of Pharma PSUs of India, that is BPPI, has entered in an MOU with the Maharashtra State Road Transport Corporation for operating 560 Jan Aushadhi Kendras at bus depots. Now, target has been set to open a particular number of stores in Maharashtra or any other state. The ministry further says that since 1st of January 2016, 3,969 Jan Aushadhi Kendras have been opened in rural areas of the country, including Maharashtra. As regards Maharashtra, 355 Jan Aushadhi Kendras were opened since 1st of January 2016 to 19th of July 2019, out of which 291 Jan Aushadhi Kendras were opened in rural areas. Lastly, the government says that the target of Government of India is to open new Jan Aushadhi Kendras in henceforth unserved geographical areas. Now, opening a Jan Aushadhi Kendra is a particular area depends upon several factors, including whether an entrepreneur, NGO or society or a government organization is interested in opening a Kendra in that location. Based on receipt of an application from an eligible entrepreneur, NGO or a society or a government organization, the BPPI enters into an agreement with that applicant to open a Jan Aushadhi Kendra. Well, the next question and the last one for this episode is addressed to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and this one comes in from member Naresh Gujral, who wants to know from the government, in view of the reports of inordinate delays in settling cases by National Company Law Tribunal under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, whether government is planning to usher in some changes to the Act in order to give it more teeth and make the resolution process more time-bound.
The government has already constituted Insolvency Law Committee as Standing Committee on 6th of March 2019 to make suitable recommendations to address such issues and to enhance the efficiency of the process prescribed and for effective implementation of the code. Till 31st of March 2019, the total amount realizable by financial and operational creditor is 79,220 crore. So Vishal, that's all we could pack for our viewers in this edition of Question Hour.
Well, yes, and we'll take a short break here. After the break, our colleagues Arvind Singh and Preeti Singh will bring you some more questions in Prashnakal. Stay tuned to Rajya Sabha Television.